Welcome to OddBangers Ball, episode number 2. We switched hosts up on you. This is Matt, not Eli. But tonight, I have the pleasure of hanging out with one of my favorite Asheville bands, Temptations Wings. Introduce yourselves, guys. What do you do in the band?
Jason, I play drums.
My name's Micah, I do guitars and vocals.
My name's Ryan, I play bass.
My name's Chad, I play guitar.
So tell me about Temptations Wings. When did you start? Where did you start? Is this the original lineup? The people want to know.
Absolutely. Yeah. Far from original.
I kind of started writing some songs with a little recorder I had in my basement that I was living at the time. And so we had a little bit of a band going. We actually had a show scheduled with Jason's band at the time.
Which was?
Primed.
Primed?
Yeah,
Primed.
A long time ago.
Yeah.
So what year was this?
Oh, man.
2007. So you guys have been kicking around since 2007.
Yeah. So anyways, so that both of our bands kind of fell apart at the same time, and me and Jason hit each other up. Actually, he hit me up on MySpace, and was like, "Yeah, you want to jam sometime?" I was like, "Hell yeah, you know, let's do it." And the rest is history from there. Chad and Ryan have me and Jason are, I guess you'd say, the originals. You know, since we've been playing out. Chad and Ryan they've been in the band for, both the guys, been 3 or 4 years now, I guess.
Yeah, I started with these guys, 5 years ago, playing bass. Ryan and I were in another local band, Through the Fallen. And
So you progressed to guitar.
Yeah. So I had played guitar in that band, and Ryan played bass with me. And other bandmates, Scott and Sam, if you're watching, hope you guys are doing well. But those guys played with us, and that had ended about 5-6 years ago. And I was looking to actually take a break for a little while, and we had jammed with these guys a lot, and they were looking for a bass player change. And I was like, hey, you know, I'd been playing guitar for years, and I'd wanted to do something different. So I said, hey, why don't I come jam bass with you guys? And went really well. We wrote the Skull Thor album. That was pretty soon into me joining the band. I mean, it was within a year, and Skull Thor came out.
So say the full name of that album for me.
Skull Thor Ebonblade, or if you're British, it's Skull Thor Ebonblade.
Ebonblade. Yes.
And it's a concept album.
Yes.
Yep. All right. Not to cut you short, though.
No, you're good. You're good. So, that happened. We ended up playing a show at the Peel. And
that's the Orange Peel.
Yep, that was the last show as Through the Fallen. It was kind of a send-off for them. And coming out of that show, you know, we all hung out. And I think there was a show I couldn't make, so I suggested that Ryan play. I think that was one of the Steel and Stone festivals.
Yeah. Yep.
And luckily, I knew Ryan could hold it down. And it was, I didn't feel too bad about not being there because I know he could handle it. He did a great job. And they fired me the next day.
Yeah,
from bass.
So that's kind of a funny story. I actually, shortly after that show, I'd been thinking, you know, kicking things around in my head, and I texted Jason. I was like, "What if we asked Ryan to be the bass player?" And Jason's like, "You talking about firing Chad?" I was like, "No. Like, let's make Chad play guitar again, and we can do some guitar harmonies finally, and we'll keep Ryan on bass."
Which you do. You do guitar harmonies.
Yes.
Yeah, it was it was asking for it, you know. Even writing a lot of the bass stuff on the Skull Thor album, there was a lot of harmony in there between the bass and the guitar. So when we converted over and brought Ryan in and started playing as a 4-piece, it just, a lot of those songs we kind of rewrote those pretty quick to have the second guitar, which you can hear on one of our live albums. It's the first time that we're all together. And since then, I've obviously written the Path EP, which came out last year, and now we're working on some new material, which should be done this weekend, if I heard correctly. Maybe. First four. So just trying to get a break from everything going on to figure out when we can get back in there and finish it. So
you're watching this probably in response to and during a pandemic. So we are the Auditorium. That's who I represent. Obviously, you'll see that on the channel. We were kind of hoping to keep some relevance, so we've asked some of our favorite bands to do this OddBangers Ball with us. So tell me about concept albums. You know, metal has tropes, right?
Yeah.
And concept albums are almost synonymous with metal music. They are in other genres, but those genres suck, right? It's usually about love or life.
Yeah, we don't write about that stuff.
Or live. So tell me about the concept album that you did before the EP, and what was the concept?
That's all these guys, because they come up with all the lyrics and most of the visuals. I've always been all about music.
Yeah.
And I've always stepped away from the lyric part of it. So there's some songs, embarrassingly, I have to ask them still. I'm like, what's the name of the song? Because I write most music, and once I do that, they take it and run with it with all the concepts and lyrics.
As a true Shred Lord should. Man doesn't concern himself with anything other than the shred.
I don't concern myself with words.
So tell me about the concept album, though. Like, what was the concept? Obviously, I was in there a little bit because I think I did some Photoshopping for you.
Yep.
It's outlaid on this amazing art done by...
David Paul Seymour.
David Paul Seymour from Minnesota.
Yes.
Tell me about that concept. I know it's like kind of got some Medusa vibes.
Yeah.
Well, we had these songs, and they're all kind of like the same vein as like subject matter. Mm-hmm. And then I think it was Amon Amarth released the Young Viking album, and I really liked that album a lot. And I was like, why couldn't we do something like that? So we had all these songs, and I was like, I just texted Michael one day randomly, as I usually do, with some weird ideas. And I was like, hey man, I was like, why don't we like put all these together like Amon Amarth did, and like, just make up some cool name like Skeletor and Thor. And then I was like Skull Thor or something.
I love it.
And he was like, yeah, that's cool. And then he's like, yeah, his last thing could be Evenblade. I was like, sweet. And there, that was pretty much the start of like putting it all together.
Yeah. So he's got a black blade, you know, so he becomes known as Skull Thor Evenblade. And so basically the concept, short version, is he comes home from whatever he's been doing and his village is burning. He sees a witch on the outskirts of town, swears revenge. So he knows he's going to need like a powerful weapon to defeat this witch. So he goes and he sees a blacksmith. He encounters Poseidon, you know, when he's sailing to go see the blacksmith. Fights Poseidon, gets his sword made. Then he needs some more money after that, so he takes his contract on a Gorgon. Mm-hmm. And he goes and basically sacrifices his guys for greater power, and he goes back to the guy that offered him the contract. The guy tries to steal his Gorgon head, and he basically kills that guy because he betrayed him. Then he makes his way to the forest where the witch lives. There's a big battle with the witches, a lot of death. Basically all his troop of guys with him die. He's all but beaten, and he happens to just reach out, and there's his Gorgon head. He freezes the witch in stone, smashes her with his warhammer, and then he dies and goes to Valhalla.
It's epic.
That was the short version.
Yeah. That's the short version.
The long version is about 48 minutes.
Yeah. Yeah.
So the last thing I want to talk about before I talk about what influences each one of you to be in this band, and why you do it, and how you write the music and approach the music, I want to talk about Still and Stone Fest.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So Still and Stone Fest, if you're not familiar with it, and many of you probably may be, or you might not be, is a metal fest that these fine gentlemen put together, hosted at the auditorium. It is a great success and showcases a lot of regional metal bands. Sometimes we get some bands from further away. Mm-hmm. Talk about Still and Stone Fest. Well, this would have been the
fifth
year.
Yeah, fifth.
It's crazy.
Yeah.
So to put that in perspective, the auditorium has been open since 2013. So we've kind of rode the wave together, you know.
Yeah,
awesome.
So
that was another random text I sent Micah. It's like, we should just start our own festival because nobody else ever invites us to their festival. Basically, that's how it started.
Hey, if you build it, they'll come.
Yeah, right? Yeah. And like, so the first year was pretty tough on me because I really didn't know what I was doing. I found out like bands like money. Mm-hmm. A lot. They want a lot of it if they have to travel. And I didn't have it, so it was a learning process. But the first year we had Cloak from Atlanta, mm-hmm. which is pretty big now. And then the second year we had Horseburn. Yeah. The third year we got lazy and we just headlined. And then last year we had Howling Giant from Nashville. Yep. And all the bands that have headlined except for us have had the opportunity to go tour Europe, but obviously didn't happen because of the COVID. But,
yeah.
So yeah, if you want to tour Europe, come headline our festival.
Yeah.
Good things will happen for you.
For you.
Big things will happen for you. Yeah. But so, no, it's fun because it seems like all the opening bands like it, and most everyone's just cool with the spot, no matter where it is, whether it's opening or, you know, fourth or whatever.
So, yeah, and it's generally seven-ish bands.
We tried 7 1 year. And last year, I think Yatra jumped on last minute, mm-hmm. so we tried 7 twice.
Yeah.
But 6 is a sweet spot, I think, for me.
And it happens primarily in November.
It's usually the first Saturday after Election Day.
Yeah.
So everyone can just drink and forget about the problems.
A little cleanse the palate, if you will.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, lastly, what influences you guys as individuals to play metal music? And I know you got rippers and you got bass. But you rip on the bass. So I want to know, personally here, maybe the viewers at home or on their phones, why and who. Give me, like, Jason's on the drums, little Jason's hanging out at home 40 years ago.
Yeah. 40 years ago, I wasn't playing any drums because I'm 40 now, so.
Might have been.
19-year-old Jason would be a better person to ask about that.
Was that just, like, straight-up satanic shit?
No, you know, actually, growing up around here, I used to be kind of leery about the satanic artwork albums. It's like, I remember getting the first White Zombie, like, studio release, and it had, like, all the demon artwork and everything on it, and it's called Devil Music Volume 1.
Yeah.
And I remember I got the CD from, like, Columbia House or BMG, which I never paid.
Oh, were those, like, five? Was it, like,
12 for a penny?
Yeah,
man. The best.
That's how I learned I hated Duran Duran. I got it on accident.
I got this album, and I had all the other ones. I got, like, I think Vulgar Display of Power was in there, mm-hmm. and, like, some other ones. And I got this one. I was looking at it, and I was like, man, I don't know if I should listen to this, because this might make me a devil.
It's devil music.
I don't know.
Yeah.
You know? But after a while, I just said, fuck it. I tried it. Yeah, I never turned. I never looked back.
Yeah.
But no, the groove in that album was so awesome to me, man. Like, that's just what really got me interested in drums, because without the drums, that album probably wouldn't be all that great. Just like Rob Zombie's solo stuff, it's all electric drums and shit like that.
Yeah, I bet his movies would be better if they put drums in them too.
See, so that, and, like, you know, then I moved on to a little harder stuff, obviously old Metallica, Pantera, Slayer, Rainbow, like the classic stuff, Maiden, Priest. So, yeah, awesome. I was running the gamut. Bill Ward, obviously. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I was running the gamut of awesome stuff. Decided I wanted to do that.
Cool. What about you with your flying bee?
For me, I was 13 when I started, so that's almost 24 years I've been playing, and I still suck.
Yeah, we all do, man. Keeps us together. We can't leave to go join other bands because we're just not good enough.
The reason I picked up a guitar was because my dad was in a bluegrass band. Actually, my whole family was bluegrass musicians. Mm-hmm. So I picked up a guitar. I wanted to play Led Zeppelin at the time because that was really what I was into. My mom got me into Led Zeppelin. And from there, I discovered Master of Puppets and, you know, the first few Sabbath albums. And that's the reason I kept playing. But as far as influences today, Iron Maiden with the guitar harmonies, mm-hmm. Monomarth with the melodic riffing, and you know, good thrash, good doom, and Sabbath.
Grand Magus,
yeah, another favorite.
Yeah, so I started probably about 15 years ago also playing guitar. Started working at a local automotive shop with this guy over here, and they needed a bass player.
Bass is actually very challenging.
And I was like, I've never played it. He was like, well, just come on over to the house. I got a bass and let's play. And started playing bass. I got in heavy metal music, probably like Master of Puppets is big, the Kill 'Em All album. Started getting into Megadeth. Probably Mike Inez is my biggest influence. Alice in Chains was his groove, mm-hmm. and him and Jerry Cantrell, big influences, their songwriting, the lyrics, and Alice in Chains is really huge. But started getting in, you know, Pantera and, you know, the thrash stuff is really big for me. I wasn't a huge doom person until I started hanging out with these guys. They start texting me stuff like, listen to this, listen to that. So I started to...
I think we're now called Thrash Doom.
Yeah. Appalachian Power
I'd like
Power
to say
Doom.
It's some of our fault. Appalachian Power Doom.
Yeah. So I started listening to some
Patrick
of that.
Patrick Whitaker made that one up. I know he'll be watching.
Shout out to Patrick.
Yeah.
Cool, man. Thank you, Patrick. Awesome, man. Yeah, so just like these guys said, I mean, same time frame, 15 years old. I was in strings orchestra in school, and I know, you know, learning all that crap, and you know, doing that. And I was at a buddy's house, and Black Sabbath came on the radio, and he had a guitar, and I picked it up and kind of figured out how to play Iron Man, and I couldn't figure out the intro. You know, I was like, how does this happen? And that, I was hooked at that point. And parents were big into rock music, Van Halen. My mother has half of a Van Halen pick. When I was a kid, I remember asking her, going through photo albums, she had this half of a Van Halen pick. And what is this? And she said, I caught that at a Van Halen concert and gave the other half to my friend. And I was like, who's Van Halen? And, you know, that was the start right there. It was, you know, I think we bought Van Halen 1 on cassette close to that time frame and took a trip to Charlotte and put it in, and I listened to it front to back, and I was like, I've got to do this. So,
and that makes sense because the shred happens on both ends through 5153s. So
yes. Yeah, those love those guitar amps. Yeah. We could talk about 4 hours about those amps alone.
Just about the amp. Right now.
Yeah. Cool, guys. So we're gonna get into some music. I'm gonna post some PayPal links below, some links to the band. We're gonna post all the albums. Hopefully. Point of this is to keep music alive during this time. The auditorium is not able to have shows at the moment, so I missed it. These guys probably missed playing it, so they have an audience of me and the camera crew and the sound guys. So let's get to it.
All right.
Awesome. Sounds good. Thanks.
Thank you.
All right, we're going to play our EP that came out just a little over a year ago called The Path. This song is called Murkwood. We'll be right back.
Maybe Jason's
that makes four of us.
Last moment on stage.
All right, we're going to play a couple from our upcoming album, which will be released sometime at some point, probably next year due to COVID, which sucks. But, you know, we're all in kind of a crappy boat because of COVID. We're here for the auditorium trying to help raise some funds for these guys. We really appreciate being here. Thank you guys for filming us. We really appreciate that, too. We've always wanted to have a nice kind of video type, you know, almost DVD kind of thing going on. So it's really awesome to be here. We encourage you to donate to the auditorium. There's a tip jar set up for us too, but we encourage you to donate to the auditorium. If you feel like donating to us, that's cool, but please take care of the auditorium first, because they're very good to us and have been for a very long time. So without further ado, here's the Silent Assassin. All right, another new one entitled Sea of Woe. It's a little weird, but it's cool. It's good to be out playing.
Yeah, yeah. Woo!
Yay! We'll cheer
sounds
for
like
ourselves.
A show now.
All you guys in the back.
You guys went on the bathroom.
Who's playing?
We'll be right back. We got one left. This is the one about battling Poseidon on the open sea. It is called Into the Maelstrom.